think back on these times and the dreams we left behind. I'll be glad, 'cause I was blessed to get to have you in my life. When I look back on these days, I'll look and see your face. You were right there for me.
I followed close behind her, Danny boy, the pipes are calling. From glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone and all the roses fallen. It's you must go. And I must bide. But come ye back when summer's in the meadow, or when the valley's hushed and white with snow. I'll be here in sunshine or in shadow. Oh, Danny boy, oh, Danny boy, I love you so. But if you come and all the flowers are dying, and I am dead, as dead I will may be, you'll come and find the place where I am lying, and kneel and say an Ave there for me. And I will know, though soft ye tread above me, and then my grave will richer, sweeter be. And you'll bend down and tell me that you love me, and I will rest in peace until you come to me.
Soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart's burden be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains.
You raise me up to walk on stormy seas.
I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. There's no life, no life without its hunger. Each restless heart beats so imperfectly.
But then you come and I am filled with one. wonder.
Sometimes I think I glimpse eternity.
You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong.
Good afternoon, everyone. Are you all there?
Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. Oh, well, thank you all for coming out today to honor this exceptional man and his life and his legacy. So we're here today to honor John's life and what he gave to you and to all of us and to this church and to the church in Tucson, Arizona. We're here to remember the gifts that he brought to the world and to each of you. We're here also to support the family in this time of grieving. I'm sure all of you who knew him are grieving, and especially the family. So we're here to support them. We're here to also be here for one another, to be in community, which we haven't had much of lately. But the importance of community support cannot be overestimated. And so we're here for one another. We're here to honor the sacredness of life and to remember that when we go back into our day and our life and our world, that the man that we're honoring today would want us always to live fully, lavishly, loving with all we've got, like he did. So on occasions like this, I have a quote that I like to share, and I invite people to greet one another. We're all probably used to hugging one another, but we're not going to do that this afternoon. What I do ask you to do, though, is when I've finished reading the quote from a book called How Then Shall We Live? How Then Shall We Live Knowing We Will Die? By Wayne Muller. When I've read that quote, I'm just going to ask you to maybe stand up and turn around and just kind of wave your hands at people, just so we connect as a community here. Here's what he said. Being in community with others is an inescapable part of a full and meaningful life. Gathering to observe ritual, ceremony, festival, birth and death, these are the ways we remember the rhythm of things, the triumph of the human spirit, the deepening of life together. And so when we ache for God, when we celebrate the sacredness of life, we sit together. We pass the kiss of peace. We hold one another's hands in prayer. And we remember our love in the company of the family of God. And so remembering that love that lives in all of our hearts, will you stand up and just wave your hands and send some love out to one another today? love, 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 love. Thank you all. Thank you all. I'm so glad to welcome the Reverends Larry and Mary Ellen Schwarz here today, longtime ministers here in the Phoenix area and in Arizona, and a wonderful, extraordinary church in Tucson, Arizona. So Larry and Mary Ellen, will you raise your hands so we can all welcome you here? And good friends of John, very good friends of John, so thank you for coming on up from Tucson. A prayer that was a part of John's spiritual practice, I'm going to share with y'all, you may know it. So John, this one's for you. God, we offer ourselves to thee to build with us and do with us as you will. Relieve us of the bondage of self that we may better do your will. Take away our difficulties, that victory over them may bear witness to those we would help of thy power, thy love, and thy way of life. May we do thy will always. Amen. And so we say, Lord of life, font of love, and source of all that is good, we pray now. We pray now and gather today to celebrate and give thanks for the blessings and gifts that John brought into the lives of all who knew him. We give thanks that you comfort the heart of Patty, the heart of his daughter Lori and his family today, and all of his friends. We all adjust then to the loss of this amazing man, and we know that you are walking each one through it with grace. Comfort and reassure all of us here as you embrace John in your oceanic love. Let this day make a space for your grace and a renewal of a passion for life that John demonstrated. And so we let his resilient spirit inspire all of us in our own lives. This is our prayer, Lord. Amen and amen. And now a song that I'm sure was a part of John's life as well, the Prayer of St. Francis. So we ask that God make us all channels of that peace that the song speaks of. I should have introduced myself. My name is Sharon Connors, and I'm privileged to be the minister here at Unity Spiritual Center in Sun City. And so I did not have the great honor of knowing John except through Patty. And some of the folks here are congregants who served with him, who knew him well, and they may want to speak today about that experience with him. I just want to say a couple of words that stand for our unity teaching on this cycle of birth and death. And what we would say and what I say is that the spirit of John is right here. That his presence, though invisible, is reachable. That there is really no death of spirit. It's just that we lay the body down. So this isn't the end. This is a new beginning for John. And Patty could probably speak to what she suspects he might be doing next. Or perhaps Lori. Maybe he'll be a stand-up comedian, right? From what I've heard anyway. But he'll be in service somewhere. We know that about John. And so this life that we've been given is for us to express love the best we can. And today, as you remember John and all the people you love, we know that what we love and who we love gives us courage. So may that knowledge that what we love gives us courage, know that John's spirit is giving us all courage in these times or any time. So today, as we gather together as a community of love to remember John, remember that even when you leave here, he's always in our hearts. That spirit is always in our hearts because we are one in the one. Well, having said that, I am honored to invite the Reverend Larry Schwartz to share the eulogy. Come on, let's go, Larry.
Hello. I'm honored to be here, Mary Ellen and I. For a number of reasons. Among them is Patty being here with you and to hold you in the light and in the love that we have for you and John and family. And over the years, Mary Ellen and I are recently retired after 53 years in Unity of Tucson. So we've known John for 40 some years, a little over maybe in that area. And we've done many happy, wonderful things together, we and John together. And it's nice to be able to remember, isn't it? Now, memory sometimes can play a real trick on us because we are reluctant to see change. But change, as we can tell by the masks we wear, are very interesting, and they happen, and it's our joy to move with them. And that is exactly what has happened in the process of the one we love that we call John. Over the years, I have had many services such as this, and I include in what I do a poem that was written by a good friend of ours, J. Sieg Paulson. We've known him for many, many years. And Sieg said it in this way. He said, "They know me not, who think that I am only flesh and blood, a transient dweller on the fragile spaceship Earth that gave me human birth. For I am spirit, eternal, indestructible, not confined to space nor time. And when my roles are through and I have laid aside this spacesuit called my body, I will move on to other mansions, roles, assignments in our Father's house of eternal life. So dry your tears, weep not over much for me or for yourself. Set me free in the love that holds us all and makes us one eternally. Our paths will cross again. Our minds and hearts will touch. Our souls will shout with joy and laughter as we recall the lives we've lived, the ways we've seen, if we find ourselves at last consciously in God. I like to remember and to remind those who give me the opportunity to speak and to remind them of something that you know innately and intuitively deep within you, that you are not the body that you are wearing. You're just, it is just giving you mobility within this dimension of the never ceasing, never ending experience of life in God. And like John, you and I will both have the opportunity to move on into the non-physical. And the opportunity that we have is to take away any guile or any fear or any thing that allows us to have any kind of apprehension. Folks, we've been doing this for a long time. We just don't remember. We've been in and out of dimensions and in and out of frequencies so many times. And we bring with us on an innate, dear truth within you and within me, the knowledge of life and life eternal, and that's all we ever are. So where do we go? There's only here, there's only now. There's nothing else. I know that if you would have, and I know people who do, I don't. And sometimes I wish I had, but it's a two-edged sword as well. But many, many people that I know have the ability to see what I can't see. And I believe if you could see truly in this room, you would see the smile that is John. And he is very aware that you are here today and that we have that innate connectivity within us and him and all that we together love. I would ask you to do something, or at least to consider it. And Patty and I talked about this a little bit ago. And it is to remember that John is not a was. John is an is. And it's so easy to fall into the trap of saying the past tense as we think about John or anyone else that is no longer in this dimension. But that's a disservice, I think, to the inner connectivity that you have with all that is life and all that is wisdom and all that is knowing. John continues to be ever much more than perhaps we ever considered him to be. So John is an ongoingness. John is life encapsulated, and that can never cease, that can never stop. And that's true about anyone else that you might think about, think of, that you have had in your life, that you can let your mind touch on right now. And they are also an is, as long as you let them be an is. If you transfer them to a was, then you are removing a certain point of love and connectivity that you yet have with them. You can have moments with John if you care to. You just have to train yourself to be open and receptive. I believe that in the future, if all of a sudden you have a certain memory of John, that you are picking up on something that he is telegraphing. And anytime you care to, you can do the same thing to him. In your times of quiet, you can have your own conversation. Hi, John. You know, what you doing? How's things? Isn't it an adventure? What a wonderful experience you must be having. And have another conversation. We remember John. Maybe you saw John's picture in the Dead Sea a little bit ago that was projected. He wanted so much to have an experience in the water at the Dead Sea. He dove in. You don't do that in the Dead Sea. He was a wreck for a little bit. His eyes were red and watering, but by golly, he dove into the Dead Sea, and he floated on his back, as you can see, and that was fun. You saw a picture of him as well, dressed as a disciple. We did that at Unity of Tucson for many, 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 many years on our Christmas Eve service. People dressed up as a disciple, and they had a role to play and a little thing to say and everything. North of Tucson, yet in Tucson, somehow I was at a stoplight once, and John was also at that stoplight. And we just said hi to each other, and John pulled over, and I pulled over behind him. And he was the disciple Philip, I believe, at that point in time. And John got out of the car, came over to the window my window, I rolled it down, and he spoke his piece about the disciple, turned around, got back in his car, and drove off again. And we smiled about that, he and we, for many times. So John is, and the truth is, there is but one presence, one power, and it is life. And we all have the experience of, as I said a few moments ago, of making a dip or a climb, if you will, whatever you care to say, into the non-physical. And then at some point in time, I believe that for a variety of reasons, we make the choice to again come to where the action is. And that's here, in this dimension, with the sights and the smells and the different things that take place here in an outer way. And at some point in time, if you have unfinished business with John, trust the process. You will again have that moment. You will again have a deja vu, perhaps, that we all have had experiences like that, and you sort of say, as we all have on some level of our being, I should know that person because we have this kind of interchange, or I should know what's around that corner because I've been here before. And you'll have those moments, and conceivably, you will be able to rub shoulders with John and have that wonderful, wonderful experience of goodness to share with him. John is very much alive within my mind and heart. Not a was, but an is. And that is the truth of who and what John is. So my part in this time of sharing, my closing time, is simply to think of John and the Marine Corps that John so dearly loved. I called him every November 10th, is it? And we sang together the hymn, the Marine Corps hymn. I did that just for fun. And John looked forward to my call. And so, John, simplify. Simplify. And all is well. Love you, Betty.
I assume you all knew that. That was the Marine hymn, right? And I'm featuring that John was standing at attention somewhere and enjoying the fact that we played one of his theme songs. So Patty has wonderfully gotten together some videos that we'd like to show now people near and far who will share a little bit about John right now.
Stop.
Patty, I can't believe we're at this place in time. Oh my goodness, I was so honored to be there when you and John met. It was such an exciting day in Tucson to come to the airport, and you'd just come back from up in Seattle. And John and you met and sat together on the plane. You were all dressed up to the nines with a fancy hat on, and you introduced me to the man, John. And it began from there. And you guys were so blessed with this wonderful, wonderful marriage. Lots of love for each other. Journeying all around the U.S., inviting me to come to all of these different homes you've had and places you've been. And John was always so loving and caring and welcoming to me. I always appreciated that. Some highlight spots I remember, listening to the Scottish music with him. I know how much he loved that. Or singing his military, his Marine songs. It was just so much fun. And your homes, remember we went into, when you were living in Plano, and we went to the local, not the complex you lived in, but another local complex, just so that we could all sit around in the hot tub all day. That was so much fun. So, John is in a better place right now. We know he's in heaven, we know he's happy, we know that he knows you today. He didn't know you when he passed, but he knows you again, and he's always gonna be with you. And again, I'm so grateful for all of our friendships and times together, and may he rest in peace, and his soul and all the souls of the faithful departed through the mercy of God, rest in peace, amen. Love you, Patty.
Hello, my name is Mike Cullen, and I'd like to share just a few of my remembrances of John Schott. John loved AA. He loved his wife, Patty, his children, his friends. He loved the Marines and his country. I was privileged to know him while he lived in Texas. John was a committed member of the Allen Group of Alcoholics Anonymous, which was both of our home group. John asked me to be his sponsor when he was living in Texas, but he wanted to make sure I had a sponsor first though. He believed in sponsorship. And despite the fact that I was his official sponsor, I am quite certain that I learned much more from John than he did from me. John had a specific way that he liked to read the 12th step. Having had a spiritual awakening as the result of these steps, John taught me what an amazing and powerful promise that is that's contained in the first part of that 12th step. I've shared that lesson hundreds of times with sponsees and in meetings. John had an enthusiasm for life. He came to my Adirondack men's retreat as a 75-year-old man. John loved the fellowship and wanted to keep up with the rest of the youngsters. He insisted he come with us when we climbed a short but very steep mountain. John always had a neatly folded list in his shirt pocket, and he took fastidious notes. It was an awesome way for him to compensate for his failing memory. I remember sharing that with my mom when she was early on in her Alzheimer's journey. I remember speaking to John shortly after he and Patty moved to Arizona, and he very matter-of-factly shared with me his dementia diagnosis. He had clearly accepted it with humility and with grace. My life is better for having known John. He will be missed.
If you can keep your head when all about you are losing theirs and blaming it on you, if you can trust yourself when all men doubt you, but make allowance for their doubting too, if you can wait and not be tired by waiting, and being lied about, don't deal in lies, or being hated, don't give way to hating, and yet don't look too good nor talk too wise. If you can dream and not make dreams your master, if you can think and not make thoughts your aim, if you can meet with triumph and disaster and treat these two imposters just the same, if you can bear to hear the truth you've spoken, twisted by knaves to make a trap for fools, and watch the things you gave your life to broken, and stoop and build them up with worn out tools.
If you can make one heap of all your winnings and risk it in one turn of pitch and toss and lose and start again at your beginnings and never breathe a word about your loss, if you can force your heart and nerve and sinew to swerve your turn long after they are gone and so hold on when there is nothing in you except the will which says to them, hold on. If you can talk with crowds and keep your virtue, or walk with kings nor lose the common touch, if neither foes nor living friends can hurt you, if all men count with you but none too much, if you can fill the unforgiven minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run, yours is the earth and everything that's in it, and which is more, you'll be a man, my son.
The spirit is certainly here, isn't it? Maybe we should all sing the Marine hymn together. We'd like now to allow some of you folks out there, first and foremost, his daughter Lori, to share some special memories. So I'll bring the microphone down to Lori first, and then if any of the others of you would like to share a special memory about John, please feel free to do so.
Incredibly kind of you all to be here. Okay, thanks. Today, whether in person or virtually, to celebrate my dad's life. I really appreciate the many ways that people have shared how he's touched them and impacted them. So thank you. And Larry and Mary Ellen, thank you so much for making the journey. Just so many years of knowing him. That means a lot. Patty and Barb, thank you for making this possible. When I think of my father, I keep remembering his incredible, playful relationship with words and music. My dad was always impishly crafting something. I looked up to make sure that word was the right one to use, and it definitely is. His mind was constantly brewing up the next joke, pun, limerick, or jingle about someone or something. He worked crossword puzzles and number puzzles. He patiently taught me to play chess, and we did jigsaw puzzles together. And he was always at the ready to sing some made-up-on-the-spot song or any number of his many favorites, as you have probably guessed, Amazing Grace and the Marine Corps hymn being the tops. His mind in constant motion in a truly creative and playful ways. I think Dad epitomized the phrase, never met a stranger. He would talk to anyone, literally anyone, at any time. Excuse me, and he was genuinely welcoming and accepting of people in a way that was truly beautiful. This definitely showed in the 4.5 decades of his active involvement with AA. No matter where he was living or traveling, he went to meetings and always connected with people. I was so fortunate to grow up in a safe, caring, and abundant home, and I never doubted for a minute that he loved us and was proud of us. In adulthood, he regularly made journeys to visit each of us wherever we were living, wanting to stay connected with his kids, his daughter-in-law, Cielo, and his granddaughters, Mercedes and Anna Mae. While they were not able to be here in person, those two handsome guys that did the poem, If, by Rudyard Kipling, are my brothers, Mark and Matt. And I realized when we were talking about that, though we may not have known every single word of that, it just was a part of our language growing up, and I really appreciated that. I tried to write a limerick to celebrate and honor my dad's life, and I just couldn't seem to do something to match his skill, which is probably better, because if it were truly a reflection of him, it would not be appropriate for public airing. And you're all laughing because you know it's true, don't you? But my brother Mark said it so well, and I know they were sorry they couldn't be here in person, but I'd like to share his note on behalf of us. It says, Dad, I am forever grateful for your life, for your love and your life lessons. Thank you for teaching us the value of respect, to open doors for others, and to be kind. Thank you for coaching our sports teams and being fair while doing it. Thank you for showing us our country and for a happy childhood. Thank you for being an active member of our lives and for being parts of our family. We will miss you until we meet again. Thank you.
These are some memories that were sent in that these people would like read for the service. This is from Bill Pourvu in Cambridge, Massachusetts. He says, in September 1956, I met John. We two 22-year-olds were assigned to be roommates for the first year of the MBA program at Harvard Business School. He was California, I was Boston. Despite, or perhaps because of it, John became not only a great friend, but a favorite of everyone who met him. His enthusiasm, his sense of fun were contagious. A couple examples. John was the only person I know who wrote his papers, his exams, in limericks. At times, he would raise his hand at the end of class. When called on by the professor, he would ask permission to read a limerick that he wrote during the class. An offering that often made gentle fun of the professor. Who could be upset at anything John said? The class obviously loved it. On another occasion, John saved me. I was engaged to Leah, my wife now of 62 years. Friends of my parents were giving a big party in our honor. Leah came down with some sort of childhood disease and was able to come up to Cambridge from New York. John said he would handle it. First, picture this. Leah was 5'2", very slight. John was a muscular 220 pounds. John got himself an apron, made a sign that he hung around his neck saying he was Leah, and circulated brilliantly. John's muscular build was not an accident. He swore to me that while at Stanford as an outstanding math major, he not only took a course in weightlifting, but he took it himself and he gave himself an A. True or false, who cares? That was John. By spring of that year, John realized he really was not ready for business school and decided to join the Marines. I will never forget one of the first letters I got from John while he was finishing boot camp. He commented that the food was great, and he was the only person in his squad who had gained weight during his time there. He loved the Marines, but did say that he was a bit taken aback during a mock invasion of an island. John was so excited that he was first ashore. Then he later realized the odds of his survival were not too high if the invasion was for real. At the time of our 25th reunion, I convinced John to come back and spend time with us. He was afraid no one would remember him. Naturally, John was at the center of everything. People thanked me for getting him to come. Over the years, we saw each other only occasionally. I respected John's dealing with his alcoholism and his commitment to helping others suffering from addictions. I saw how Patty became the perfect companion to bring out the best in John. From my standpoint, at 85 years old, I still remember vividly that day, wonderful day in September 1956, 64 years ago, when John came into my life. This is from John Cardoza in Los Altos, California. I met John 70 years ago when we were teenagers at Modesto High School in Modesto, California. I believe we met as members of one of the school's clubs. We also had several mutual friends belonging to that club. I'm not able to attend the memorial service, nor am I very proficient at making a video selfie, but I would like to say a few words about the John Schott I knew so many, many years ago. What I remember about John is the big welcoming smile he always had, and it was the same many years ago when I visited him in Tucson, Arizona. Life has its ups and downs, but John always had a smiling face, and it was good to see him that way after all these years. In high school, John was a very popular student. He was voted class president in his senior year. Sorry, that was vice president. He was one of the smartest students and was awarded a trophy upon graduation, naming him Outstanding Boy, MHS, 1948 to 1952. He was a straight A student except for 1B. He got his last semester in school. How and why he got it is too long a story to go into here. He was also athletic and played football as well. I remember vividly a few instances during our school years. When he turned 16, he got a new car, a 1946 Mercury, and he drove over to my house to proudly show it off. And the night we graduated, John and I sneaked into the Del Rio Country Club, where his parents were members, and dove into the swimming pool. The reason I can remember this is that I had jumped in feet first, and in midair, I noticed my brand new watch on my wrist that my parents gave me for graduation. We were both accepted to Stanford after high school. I lost track of John after that, except for the visit to Tucson, as we went our separate ways. John was a proud Marine, as is my only son. Semper Fi, John. May you rest in peace. John Cardoza. And another memory from Gail Schultz in Tucson, Arizona. John was a great sponsor and really helped me in my early sobriety. I remember one good episode. He called one day and said, Gail, I've made arrangements for you to speak at the Sunday business and professional men's meeting. He didn't ask me if I wanted to, just told me it was set up. I loved the meeting, and it became one of my favorite places to go on Sunday mornings. Thanks, Gail Schultz.
Take a deep breath, everybody. Who else?
Anybody else? Oh, wait, someone back here, Patty.
Hi there. I didn't something the gentleman said earlier about John is, I didn't get to meet John, but John is. And that's really reminiscing in my heart because of the program that I'm included in as well. He affected somebody else's life, which in turn affected my life. And that's why I'm here today, for the opportunity to learn about John. And I'm so glad that I was invited. But thank you all. And I'm sad that I didn't get to actually meet the man. But he inspired another man, which is inspiring me. And I hope to be who John is just from hearing your guys' comments. And thank you.
Hi, everyone. I was fortunate enough to sponsor John in about the last 10 years of his life, and it was really an honor. Patty and John and I and my wife, on several occasions, we went up to various events. It was quite an experience, you know, and he, in his later years, he couldn't get around, so we built. B and I drove him to the Men's Stag in Avondale, and he really looked forward to that. He really enjoyed that meeting. It was one of his favorites, and he will be missed. But he's in my heart. I have good memories of him, and he'll as long as I'm alive, he'll be alive, and it's just that simple. And I know that he's in a much better place today. Because when his mind left before his body, it was not a good scene at all. So I know that they're coupled up together, and wherever he's at, he's doing fine. I'm sure of that.
Thank you.
Well, first I want to say thank you all for showing up here, especially Larry and Mary Ellen from Tucson, because I know how close they were to John, but they've also been very special to me as well. Larry married John and I 26 years ago last month, and you did good work. it worked, so I'm impressed. He's known for the jokes. So anyone who does know John knows he has a unique sense of humor. And some of you may have even been poked fun at in some of John's jokes, puns, and limericks. But he never meant to hurt anyone with his jokes or puns. He just wanted you to like him. He was brought up with his father telling bad or inappropriate jokes. And since his father was always popular, he just always equated jokes with being liked. John always tried to get me to laugh at his jokes, which was interesting sometimes because some of them were so bad. I just had to roll my eyes or groan. But John was actually a very naturally, very funny man. He was a great straight man, you know. He never understood that. So we did have a lot of laughter as well as love in our marriage. I thought it was very appropriate. In the end, John should have the last laugh, or in this case, the last gasp. As John was approaching making his transition, he started doing something called fish breathing. It's breathing through your mouth, making a gasping sound with usually longer and longer intervals in between each breath. And when that started, the nurse on call came in. She and I stood vigil over John, waiting for him to pass. The nurse was checking his pulse while his pulse got slower and slower. Finally, it seemed to stop, and she was not feeling a pulse. She told me very gently that John had passed and that she was going to step out of the room for me to be able to say goodbye to him. After she left, I went to John and leaned over, putting my arms around his neck. And just as I did, he sort of rose up and gave out a loud gasping breath that shocked me. And I ran out of the room calling to the nurse, he's still breathing. So the nurse came rushing in, and she and I started chuckling as John was gasping and rolling his eyes and waving his hands around. He had really fooled us and caught us off guard with all the last-minute activity. And the nurse ran to get a stethoscope, and because she couldn't find a pulse in his wrist, so he was really spoofing us. So then we continued our vigil for another couple of minutes, chuckling the whole time until his last heartbeat. So I'm sure John loved making his transition with laughter in the room. And I know I will miss his love and light and laughter until we meet again, although I know he is also here, and I carry him with me. So thank you. And thank you all for coming. And the other people on the video, the first person was Nan Sauer, who's now in Atlanta, and she was the lady who stood up for John and I in our wedding. And then, I don't think her name was referenced, and then Mike Cullen, so thank you.
Thank you, Patty. The rich sharing, that you did. We have a song now that was mentioned as one of John's all-time favorites, and that's Amazing Grace. And would you introduce yourself, please?
Oh, I'm Jeffrey Middleton, and a dear friend of Patty's. And
Perfect. Thank you so much. I'm sure he's clapping too. There's a poem that I heard a long time ago that I want to share, and this one is for you, John. I read of a man who stood to speak at the funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates on the tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted that first came the date of birth and spoke the following date with tears, but said what mattered most of all was the dash between those years. For that dash represents all the time that the person spent alive on earth, and now only those who loved him know what that little line is worth. For it matters not how much we own, the cars, the house, the cash. What matters is how we live and love and how we spend our dash. So think about this long and hard. Are there things you'd like to change? For you never know how much time is left that can still be rearranged. To be less quick to anger and show appreciation more, and love the people in our lives like we've never loved before. And if we treat each other with respect and more often wear a smile, remembering that this special dash might only last a little while. We can all say that, know John, that he lived his dash exceedingly well, that the spirit of his God welcomed him into a dimension that we only guess at with an embrace and a well done, good and faithful son. So I believe that John would want us all to honor the gifts that he brought. Maybe we can't develop his awesome, naughty sense of humor. But we all know a few jokes of our own that we can share. And to, as the gentleman in the back said, that he's here because John inspired someone who is now inspiring him. Very powerful. So who might we inspire in the days that are left to each of us? And so in closing, I'll say the Irish blessing for John, and invite all of you who can to join Patty and Lori and Barb and each other and Larry and Mary Ellen. I hope you can stay for a little fellowship time over in our fellowship hall right next door. So John, may the road rise to meet you. May the wind be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon the fields of your new life, and the rains fall soft there as God holds you forever in the palm of his hand. Blessings, John. Amen and amen. You are all dismissed. You can go out this way and to the fellowship hall.